Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. What a pleasure to follow this introduction. Steve, I will concentrate now on the little details. And I do this in two ways. I will first have the German way of the energy system, and then from there make a jump into the scientific details. And please forgive me, the menu will contain real chemistry, even spectroscopy. So, energy transformation, heterogeneous catalysis from a fundamental perspective, nothing perspective without co-workers. And I would like to thank my co-workers. Maybe this is unusual in this kind of rounds here, but this is my team. I would like to thank in particular those group leaders, the whole team, and some external people who we are collaborating in. And without them, it would be impossible to show you anything. So everything goes to them. So my introduction starts the opposite way as we have heard it before. Energy systems should be sustainable. And one element in sustainability are closed material cycles for harmful and rare resources. I exclude water and oxygen from that. Many different realizations of energy systems we have heard of, and we have socio-economic boundaries in Europe, US and China is very different. So it's not very likely that one solution fits the whole planet. There are several solutions needed. We heard about decarbonization, and all the examples that we saw in the last talk, they're perfectly fine. This is certainly easily done. But decarbonization as a radical measure, that means to take out carbon from the energy system, is probably impossible. So one has to be careful how far you go there. But closing the CO2 cycle, this is well possible. And that's a different story. So in a very short diagram, what we do today is indicated here. So we take biomass that is historic, that was in the ground, and we have heard how you dig it out from there. We use a little bit of it for materials. This is what you do in chemical industry, but by and large, we oxidize the whole stuff. And then we get electricity and all our other energy uses of free energy, and we generate CO2. And half of this CO2 that we burn is just going back and is assimilated by the biomass again. This is fine. But the other half is this black circle that goes into the atmosphere, and this causes all the problems that we heard before. So it would be a good idea to get rid of this big black arrow that goes into the top. This is our problem. Now, how can we do this? That was also indicated in general, and I do this a little bit more specific here. We are very good in converting chemical energy carriers in electricity. This is Vulgo Power Station. This works not perfectly well, but it works very good. And we're also good in taking electrical energy and put it in thermomechanical energy. This is Vulgo Motors. We also have seen an example that also works quite well. But we are lousy in back-converting electricity into chemical energy carriers. That does not work. There's a little bit of it in accumulators, maybe in redox flow batteries, but the real big thing to do this in quantitative dimensions that are equal to each other is chemical energy conversion. This was the little detail part. And if we could do that with the same efficiency and with the same quality, then we burn our chemical energy carriers, we would have probably solved the problem. But we cannot do that, so there is our issue. So why is this? I will go a little bit deeper into that. So who is doing what? This is also an interesting view just from the European side on this. When you look at the world of CO2 emission, then we find few large emitters and many small ones. And Germany is a very small one. So if we do something here in Germany, it doesn't make any difference whatsoever to the global climate. If we cannot find followers that do that, it's a waste of time. This is not useful. So the climate protect is only protected if a substantial number of emitters take these steps. If anyone is doing it, it's not good. And even without the CO2 problem, the growing scarcity of useful fossil resources and also security arguments, not in the US, that's fine. Maybe not in China, but in the rest of the world, there is an issue. I think we have ample reasons to change our energy system to make it more sustainable. There are many reasons for that. And the question that we cannot afford this is something that we have to look very detailed into this, because we have to do a total balance of what everything costs and not just a little bit of it. But measures that impede the joint action of the carbon dioxide emitters are counterproductive because they generate the worst thing that you can have. This is a bad example. So if someone says energy turnaround fails, this is extremely dangerous, and we should not do that. This is very well known to you, and I just put this up because you see where Germany is. It's about the same carbon dioxide emission than the internet has. This is, gives you the right dimension. And you also see that the old perception that US is the largest CO2 emitter is no longer true. That has changed. And these big CO2 sources of emission are somewhere else in the world. We heard this also in the previous talk. Also, to make this a little bit more tangible, I compare just electricity generation top in Germany and downwards in the US. And then when you look at the ordinate scales, again, I like data, then you see that there's a slight difference. So be careful when you compare relative numbers. It's an order of magnitude. So you have always to keep this in mind. We in Germany had a rush in renewable energies, and you see this, so we have passed the electricity generation by nuclear, by renewables, that's fine. That was one of the targets of the Energiewende, but that doesn't help much. And we will go into that, the volatility issues and other things just impede this. This does not mean that in the US we have seen this, how the renewables are peaking off. They will also hit this problem pretty soon. That won't take long. So the question is, what happens to an energy system if we have a substantial amount of renewables in the grid? This is another issue. Why does this not work? So, how large is the systemic challenge? This is now again data for Germany, because I have them easily available. You always multiply these data by 50, then you know what you have to do worldwide. So power generation is the usual large CO2 source in Germany. And all renewable energies that we put in our system for all the cost of the EEG save per day 220,000 tons of CO2. This is depending if this is large or small. The global emission is 35 billion tons of CO2. So how important are 225,000 tons per day? Unfortunately, in Germany, due to regulatory deficiencies, and there are some politicians who should listen now, this all was overcompensated by the use of lignite. So the CO2 balance is not profiting a lot from this. And Germany emits daily 2.2 million tons of CO2 from energy and 2.6 million from arable land losses and agriculture. If we want to change something, and I will explain to you how we might be able to change this, chemistry will have to deal on the order of magnitude with 325,000 tons of CO2 per day in Germany. This is a small fraction of the problem, but when you think about a chemistry plant that uses 325,000 tons CO2 per day, it's a huge pipe that you use for that. A few numbers, then one understands this. We have four sources of energy, as we heard also in the previous talk, and the numbers that I give you are 1 million tons of CO2 emission per year at the database of 2013. And one sees exactly where our CO2 emission comes from. Now, we have plans in our country, as we know very well. The Energiekonzept der Bundesregierung predicts that in about 25 years from now, we have the lower numbers. And these lower numbers, grosso modo, there are scenarios that are a little bit different, about save half of the CO2 emission. And this half of the CO2 emission is still there, unless we do something else than just saving and putting in renewable electricity. And the reason for that is, of course, the volatility issue. So what we have to do is we have to take a little bit of ingenuity and take a significant amount of this renewable energy and put this into chemical energy conversion in order to close some of the CO2 cycles, not by saving, but by really closing them. But at the scale, at Germany, 325,000 tons per day. The electricity to create the hydrogen that you need to treat this is about the same amount of electricity the total Germany consumes today. Then you understand what the dimension is that we are talking about. And this all is 2% of the global challenge. That does not mean this is impossible, not by all means not. But this is huge. So we are embarking on something that has the same dimension as landing the man on the moon. And I'm very happy that we saw this last slide from the last talk. This is exactly the same type of challenge that we have here. A systemic solution is best, so what we should do, several things at the same time. Reduction of emissions by substitution and saving. The previous talk, perfect example, exactly that. This is the most important thing that we have to do now. We need renewable electricity for power and heat, this is also clear. We can do still a lot in this part of the world, maybe also in the US. Using domestic thermal energy a little bit more clever than having air conditioning systems in certain building types. And chemistry can provide energy carriers for mobility and chemical transformation. And the whole problem starts in chemical transformation. This is not where the largest amount of energy is, but it's what you said this morning. This is the strategic part of it, because there's no material in this world without chemical energy industry, and chemical industry cannot exist without raw material. This is a very close interrelation. And that is why chemistry and catalysis are very close to the heart of our challenge. This is a load curve of Germany. The blue bars indicate the gigawatts over the year, and we see we have this nice even curve because we are a well-developed country. The red bars that I show is the contribution of renewables in Germany. And you see this contribution is very substantial already. There is not many countries that can show that. But if you expand this according to the laws that we have passed in Germany, we will have in the year 2035 the green situation. So we see the amount of renewables is enormous that we have, and we have two problems. We have, in one part, way too much energy, and we still have a gap. And it has to be equilibrated. And this idea we store the green part and put it in the back end is probably the least likely to happen, because this is very expensive. This is not very economical. A more economical solution could look like this. So we take a little bit of this energy, the big peak that is there only very shortly, and try to use it thermally as much as we can. Cheapest technology for 300 hours a year. The blue part is the critical one, chemical energy conversion. This creates value in this system because we convert CO2 with excess electricity and make something useful out of this. Whatever useful is power to X. This is something that we still can debate about. And the yellow part, we use fossil fuels. Because that's by way the easiest way of doing it, the cheapest way of doing it, and this is, we have all the infrastructure for that. Now you can debate what kind of fossil fuel you want to use, and one sees quite clearly, this doesn't really matter when you compare what I have plotted here, is the ratio between primary energy that you put into your electricity and what you get out per kilowatt hour. So there's a huge debate, take your gas or lignite, yeah, okay, this is a secondary issue, and maybe a mixture as we have it now is good enough. We also see quite clearly that our renewable energies are not all of them are CO2 free, as we can also see, and one has to think about this. This is development. I'm sure in PV there is more to be gained. In wind we have heard everything has been gained, or almost everything has been gained. This is super efficient. Hydro is self-explanatory. Targets. What do we want to achieve with chemical energy conversion? Had I convinced you that this is a good idea? We need hydrogen, and we have CO2. We do not have CO2 for free because CO2 is dirty. It has to be cleaned first. That's not for free. But the hydrogen generation problem is by far the larger one. So we have to get very cheap hydrogen. With these two gases, we can easily make a few intermediates. This is methane, carbon monoxide, and methanol. And these are the corner blocks, the building blocks of the whole story. And as we are here in BASF, and not only because we are here in BASF, I have also indicated the green line, because generating the ammonia that we need for fertilizers is a very large source of CO2. And if we can use that, this is the almost most simple thing that we could do had we enough hydrogen. Because taking out all the CO2 that comes from methane steam reforming is a very comparatively simple thing to do, as it is very localized and highly concentrated, but it's way too expensive at the moment. There's no way that we could ever do that. This goes a little bit further down the line, and then we have essentially two big lines. We can either do Fischer-Tropsch chemistry, these are these red things, or we can condense methanol and then either end with ethers. This is written down in the far right. Or we can make olefins, and this all together helps the chemical industry. The ethers, you might ask, what does Schlögl do with this? This is, of course, the fuel of the future for cars. Because I'm a firm believer that we will, regardless of every battery advance that we have, we will still have a significant fleet of cars that will run on liquid fuels. And in particular, all those who have to deliver high power. So imagine a truck on batteries, could that be a problem? So this could be a solution with many advantages that we might discuss. So first summary, and then I come to real science. The chemical industry is a small player in the global energy consumption. And it's also in its CO2 emission. But this does not exclude the deep involvement of chemistry in the solution. The fact that you are not being the main problem does not mean that you should leave it aside. Chemical industry is advanced in energy integration and utilization. There's still potential, we will discuss this, but this is not our biggest thing. This is the one that you can do easiest because it's your own technology, or our own technology. But the big challenges are outside of the chemical industry. The main levers for the energy system are the competence and the technology of the chemical industry to generate sustainable chemical energy carriers. So this would be the largest operation on the planet, and it would be far larger than the volume of the chemical industry today. This is very big. The raw material change offers also challenges. Fossil and maybe a little bit of biomass, this is beautifully debatable. Sources, we need to upgrade them for as material source for the chemical industry. My view in this, save fossils as long as you can and don't burn them, because there are much better uses for fossil fuels than just putting them out of the smokestack. CO2 hydrogenation, this is the little detail that we heard before, which I call power to X, as alternative is not yet ready as a business case. Yes, I think so. And it's also not yet ready as a technology, but that does not mean it's impossible. The critical science in this endeavor is catalysis, and this is the reason why I'm talking now the rest of the time about catalysis, because with that, we won't be able to do it. And I also dare to say it's most likely heterogeneous catalysis. We will always need interfaces, because these interfaces are usually the most efficient ones that we can think of. And I could now stop this presentation and say, let's do that. Let's start here and now with this and not wait until the regulatory system or the financial system has allowed us to do this. It will take decades to put this into operation, and this is a large and difficult challenge, so do it now. Now comes catalysis. Catalysis is a small subsection of a huge area that is called systems chemistry. So we are not talking about individual things, but we put them now together. The challenge is very easy. We have reactants, we have products, we have a reactor, we put some precursors in that we call catalyst, and we operate this under known standard conditions, and then we want to know what comes out of this. This looks very simple. And in fact, if you do this on a large scale, it is also doable because otherwise all the plants that are here in Ludwigshafen would not work. So that doesn't mean we don't understand this, but the question is, do we understand the molecular details? And if we do not understand the molecular details, then we have to ask ourselves, how can we develop or optimize this? Unfortunately, reality is a little bit more complex, and I'm sorry for that. I do not work you through this diagram, this is too much. But what I want to induce to you is you start with the reactants, and then you have quite a whole chain of phenomena that you have to understand before you arrive at the product. And this is maybe more a traditional view on catalysis science, whereas this part up here is very non-traditional. This is dirty, this is deactivation, this is black magic of synthesis, this is all these things that you don't want to deal with. But these things, they contain the key to the solution. This we have to understand. And this is the remainder of the talk. Are we ready to understand this? So this is the menu. One thing that we first have to think about is that unfortunately catalysis does not work in the way that you write down an equation that you want and the catalyst does what is on the equation. Unfortunately, the catalyst does many different things. Because this is like if you have a Pandora's box, you open this by activating a molecule, and when you activate it, it usually has many pathways to do that. And of course, it will explore the molecule. Once it's activated, it will explore all the pathways, not only the one that you want. And this is the problem on it. So usually we know these pathways only for the organic part of an overall process. We certainly do not know these pathways for the life of the catalyst. And we are in raw material change, this is now my example, this is selective oxidation. We find ourselves in this fancy idea that we have one reagent, this is oxygen, and this has to do many different things at a time. You would now ask, how do you bring this now? We're talking about energy. We don't want to oxidize things, we want to reduce things. This is true. But as you are reducing it, usually you end up with a form of hydrocarbons that is unsuitable for chemical industry. So most likely, you will also have to have some oxidation step if you really want to make materials. Then you have something for the physical chemists here. We have a so-called mean field approximation that thinks everything is equal throughout the whole reactor. We use a static catalyst and say the catalyst is a star, and we don't talk about this any further, and that performs all function magically. And one of these diagrams could look like this. This is something that is very well known in this community here. You take propane, and you want to have either acrylic acid or propylene. And then, of course, you can do this according to this red pathway that I have indicated here, but unfortunately, all the other things are also happening. And now the art of the catalyst scientist would be to make the red path the only one that the catalyst is following. We are far away from being able to do that. And this is a simple reaction. This is not really very complicated. People have discovered this beautiful catalyst. This is the part of the structure. This catalyst can do this job very well. And now you ask yourself, what is the relation between this path and that structure? That was the thing that we heard this morning. So structure-function correlations are not necessarily causal. So if you understand, put this, and then you get that response, this does not mean that you have understood it. So, details of active sites are needed. Catalysts are always working on some active site. This, I think we know, no one of us has ever seen an active site working. This is, we all believe that this is there. But we have no alternative to not believing this. So, this is as far as hard science goes. So, in vanadium oxides, this is my example here, we have unfortunately the difficulty that we even in this simple system, we cannot determine what is the structure of this active site, because there are measurement problems. Mr. Heisenberg knew this already. If you want to measure something, there's always an interference between the measurement and the system that you try to study. And catalysts have this very extensively. They have the so-called pressure gap issue. So when you manipulate a catalyst, then the catalyst changes with the chemical potential, and so it does when you do the measurement. So you don't know what you have. This famous catalyst that I showed you is apparently insensitive to this, and this is why we're using it so much, because this is something for the first time that we can study, because it does not change when we do this reaction. And then I can go even deeper, and now you forgive me that I go so much into detail. This is a detail, but I want you to show to what level of accuracy you have to know things before you start, you can design this. So when you measure the oxidation state of this vanadium, then one sees with certain method, I don't explain how we do this, that the answer that you get is a strong, unfortunately, sorry, the answer that you get is a strong function of the pressure where you measure this. And measure you do, work here to 1,000 millibar. And at lower pressure you measure. And so the answers are all wrong that you get at lower pressure. This is very important for making a model how that thing works. We can give even more in detail in this, and I show you now some spectra. No, don't be afraid of this. I only want to show how far we are. We are in a position that we can understand that these features have something to do with the crystal structure of this vanadium oxide system. And if we change the chemical potential in its environment, we change the structure. And we can see accurately what happens. Because what we see is when we become more reducing, then this bond gets longer and it bends over and it forms a dimer. So this is a monomer dimer formation. It does something like that. And this is encoded into this spectra, and it takes a lot of theory to do that. And one of my big things is, if you don't have theory together with experiments, you're lost in this case. You need a lot of quantum chemical theory to decipher these things. Now, we also need not only theory, we also need model experiments, and this is why useless model experiments that never ever create a catalyst are very important in order to give us the basis on which we can do our arguments. In this particular case, it was shown to us that normal vanadium oxide systems are just passivated at the surface, and you need to bring holes and to make holes in the surface in order to activate it. And if you don't do this, it doesn't work. And fortunately and magically, the catalyst also generates holes. It has the same spectroscopic signature, but it does it by the design of the catalyst. In this experiment, we had to take hydrogen atoms and bombard the hydrogen atoms to the surface. That's not a good idea. So now we want to see these things. And this is, of course, always good. Seeing is better than believing. You don't need all these spectroscopic crap. So it's still data, but this is indirect data. But seeing has the same problem as measuring. When you take a microscope and look at such a catalyst, then you find that you can find very quickly the shape of your electron beam here. This black thing, this what you see, is the mirror image of the beam that has destroyed the sample. It takes a long time to solve this problem, but we had the chance to solve this problem, and now we can see the structure. We can really see the catalyst. What you see are the atoms, the metal atoms here. You see these holes of the crystal structure. Remember, this had these nice little flowers, and there are holes in between. And the active sites are somewhere, the atoms that are encoded here. And when you look now with high precision, then one sees that the brightness of these little blips that are atoms, they are not the same. And this is the reason, because we have two types of atoms, and they are molybdenum atoms and vanadium atoms, and they are statistically distributed in there. And this will come in a moment. This is a very important definition that we find here, and by standard analytical techniques, we would not be able to see this. So this is how magic this thing looks at a larger magnification. You see the beauty of self-organization, but you see also the problems that the self-organization is not perfect. Now, the chemist comes in, why is this not perfect? And this holds exactly the answer to the function of this catalyst. It is at the imperfections where the catalytic sites are sitting. We are not interested in this beautiful flower part here. This is not so interesting, but all these nasty little holes there, they contain the active sites, unfortunately. So the bulk of a catalyst is frustrated. Like you might be, but there's soon lunch, and then everything is better. Perfect crystals are unfortunately catalytically inactive. They exhibit stable terminations, are inert towards adsorption. So if you make a beautiful catalyst that is very nicely ordered, it's useless. Nanostructuring and bulk defects are critical for operation. This is why catalysis and nanocatalysis are the same word, and the word nanocatalysis is essentially useless, because every catalyst that works is a nanocatalyst. Static surface sites for dissociation and reaction induced dynamics is fine, and then you have dynamical sites. Now, I show you again that a TM image and analysis to give you a feeling how close we can analyze such things these days. So this is now in a different form of representation, the same catalyst that I used for you as an example, and you see beautiful where the atoms are. The atoms this time are black, and where these white spots are, there are the holes. And then when we continue, then here is the crystal structure just overlaid on this. And then when we can go now to magnifications, where we can see the metal atoms here, but we can also see the oxygen atoms that are surrounding the metal, and we can see all of these atoms. And we can see them with a precision that we can determine exactly the bond angles and distances, and I will show you in a moment why this is important. We can also see that there are these nasty defects. So here is one of these defect lines. This is a crystallographic unit cell, everything fine, and here's a defect line. And you remember, because I said about these holes, and these holes created the crystals to move between each other, and this is the reason why we have these defect lines. Fine. Now, when we go even higher in magnification, then we can see that the oxygen atoms that are surrounding the metal atoms are not equally spaced. You would always expect they are exactly, they form squares, because these are octahedra. And you see, with this kind of resolution, we can detect that some of these atoms are not in the position where they should be. They're a little off. And this is an important information, because this we can use now to detect where the electrons in the systems are. They create this misfit that we see here. So we can measure all this, and we can measure this to a much greater precision than you ever could this by X-ray diffraction, because X-ray diffraction gives you the average of this. And the average of this is, of course, insensitive to these variations. And the outcome of that is that some of these sites here, they are not in a situation where they should be. When you look at it, then you also see that these atoms are not in the center of this polyhedra. They're just a little bit displaced. And this displacement comes from extra electrons, and these electrons are the ones that do the catalytic activity, and you can verify that they are there because you have a technique that is called electron paramagnetic resonance, and this complicated spectrum shows you where these electrons are. They are sitting exactly where you would expect them. No. I can't work with this thing very well. They are here, and they are here. So this is theory, but you know that we can see this. Now, next summary, we have to rush a little bit. Catalysts are homogeneous, metastable solids, not crystals. They form in mesoscopic dimensions dynamically active sites on their way to greater stability. That means the catalyst knows where he is, and the catalyst tries to get rid of its frustration as you get over lunch. And in this endeavor to get rid of the frustration, it has to move its atoms. And as it moves the atoms, it generates the active sites. So this is a parasitic phenomenon of a crystal that wants to get in on its Friday afternoon state. Kinetic enabling of surface activation need to be accompanied by kinetic stabilization of the bulk against segregation, because if you are now the employer of this crystal, you want to make sure that it doesn't reach this Friday afternoon state too quickly. It has to go over the Friday afternoon working period. This is kinetic stabilization of the frustration. That's the art of designing a catalyst. We need insight into catalyst kinetics, forming active sites, in addition to reaction kinetics using active sites. Almost all of kineticists are in this room. They are all involved with kinetics of studying how the molecule is being transformed. But very few of us are studying the kinetics, how the active sites are being formed or how they decay again, because you think mean field approximation, everything is stable, no change. That's wrong. And this is the major thing that we have achieved over the last 30 years to understand that this idea that a catalyst is a frozen system, this is a wrong perception. So we can make a descriptor here, a qualitative one, because we do not have any measurements on this. And we plot the energy per unit cell versus the bond dynamics, that is the mean displacement of the atoms. Then we find a crystal is here. A defective crystal is much higher in energy, and a completely amorphous one has about the same energy per unit size than before, but it has a much higher dynamics. And when we compare this to functionality, then we find if you go in this direction, then you burn your material, everything burns because it's too fast. You're running too fast to completion. And you want to be in selectivity, in all kinds of selective transformations, you want to be counterintuitively at the energy maximum, not at the energy minimum. Because then only then you have selectivity in transformations. You don't want non-selective transformations. This is the core part of it. Now, the last thing, water splitting. Chemical energy conversion is unfortunately needs electrons. And these electrons come in sustainable manner only from splitting of water. That's the only real source that we have that is abundant enough. The challenge again is this. You start here. And you want this, because you want to strip off 4 electrons per water molecule. But this water molecule, as it goes to here, has all these other possibilities as well. And this is the reason why water splitting is so difficult and why not even the green leaf can do it very well. Because all these things are very nasty. These species here that I show here, they are all extremely oxidizing. And they tend to ruin the environment in which they sit. And this is the reason why there's an issue about how stable such a system can be. So what you want to study is this. We take water, make oxygen. This reaction is the big problem in water splitting, not making the hydrogen. Making the hydrogen is also a problem, but this is not so big. This is a much bigger one. This is the core challenge. And we use iridium. You're saying, hey, it's crazy. Hey? But iridium is still the best system that we have found on the planet to do that. It's very disadvantageous, they're so scarce. So in the end, we will certainly have to solve this problem as well. But first, we have to understand how it works. Now, I have 6 minutes left to explain you how it works. So I better run. One view to Master Nature. Now, Master Nature does exactly the same. Nature uses water oxidation as a platform reaction to store free energy and generate all the things that we are around has all been made by this reaction. It uses molecular water splitting with individual free electrons from photoactivation, not with electrical leads and currents. There's no current, there's no copper lead in your body. And still it manipulates electrons in a very clever and different way than we do it in technology. And when you read the literature, they say, this is the nasty, fancy, beautiful molecule that does the oxygen activation in water splitting. And it looks beautiful. It's 4 manganese atoms, 4 oxygen atoms, 1 calcium atom. You will hear more of this when we go around the discussion in here in this conference. But unfortunately, this is only half of the truth. This is not doing it. If you put this in splendid isolation, it won't do anything. Because the negative thing is you have to put it in this little beast. And this small molecule is sitting somewhere out here. And if you change any one of the more than 10,000 atoms in this thing, then it stops working. And this is the challenge that we have. Why is this so complicated, and what is exactly behind this? We understand the mechanism at this manganese oxygen system quite well, but the role of all of this complexity that you see here is still pretty dark. But we want to make this better. We have to make it 1,000 times better than nature. Okay, let's try. We use iridium, and we use again another kind of in situ analysis, high-level analytics that gives you the view on the system as it works. This is extremely difficult because how would you access an interface that is covered with water and you want to know what is the chemical nature of the top atom that is beyond the water? It's the challenge. We have somehow managed to do so. I go quickly through this. This is for the electrochemist here. They will love this. This is how such an electrode looks like. The trade name is mud crack electrode. Looks very intuitive what that is. This is all iridium. And this is composed of iridium nanoparticles. You can see them quite nicely. They're in cross sections, so fine. And they have lots of holes in between where the water can go through. That's all okay. It works. So what we find interesting, that the working surface is by no means a single system, and it is certainly not iridium metal. It's a terrible mixture of certain things. We have identified 4 different species. This is still debatable what that exactly is. This is details. But at least we can measure this, and we can access this, and we can make models and ask ourselves, how can it be that in an oxidizing environment where everything is burning away, you have iridium metal? This is completely counterintuitive again. It has to do with the stability of the system. If you make a model experiment, we take iridium oxide and warm it in the presence of water, and then the iridium oxide decomposes in iridium metal. Of course, no normal oxide on the planet does this, because always the other way around. The metal meets water, of course, is corroded. You know this from your car. You don't form iron when a car corrodes, you form iron oxide. But iridium does the other way around. And there's a good reason for that, why this is the case, and maybe this has to do with why iridium is such a good choice. 3 minutes left. I think I will make it. Practical relevance. Is this knowledge of importance to you? You would say, well, it's all academic stuff, so nice pictures, but doesn't buy you any money. It gives you the explanation for the notorious instability of these systems. And if you want to find stability, then first you have to know why it's degrading. Otherwise, it's very difficult to do that. It also gives us insight in the corrosion of carbon, of the carbon support, as a critical issue, because these usually these die because these iridium particles simply fall off their current leads. That's no good. And it is prototypical, this work, for other electrodes such as platinum, ruthenium, and manganese oxide. So you take other beautiful elements, the literature is full of this, but they all suffer the same problem. This is reality. You pass current through such an iridium electrode, and after 1 hour, the current is dead. That's not very useful. But in many test conditions, you won't even find this, because people are carefully avoiding to test the stability of such electrodes. This is, in many cases, not so nice. It lives, of course, much longer if you make the current much smaller, but the integral is more or less the same. Now, here again, you can see what the issue is. These are beautiful iridium nanoparticles that have been made here at BASF. And I've put on some carbon, and one can see the atomic structure of the iridium. But when you look carefully, then you can also see that all of these little crystals, they have very fuzzy surfaces. This is not that we were drunk when we took the picture, but this is the top iridium atoms. They are moving all the time because they're not iridium, they're hydrated iridium oxides. So they're swimming in their own water. And this is the proper environment in which it works. And if it's a rigid iridium crystal, it's not active at all. Now, when you go even closer, then you can see this in atomic resolution. You see now all the individual atoms. You see here the little crystal is falling apart. You see the zigzag line. This is now splitting in two. Also, it's only 1 nanometer large. And again, you see here all the contrast of these individual atoms. The distances are all varying. These are different degrees of oxidation that you see. This is why we saw 4 different peaks in our photoemission spectrum. This can all be analyzed in more detail, but I don't want to have 1 minute and 8 seconds, so I have to read only up. No, I skip this. Last summary, and then I'm done. Electrocatalysts behave chemically like chemocatalysts. So if you understand heterogeneous catalysis, you also understand electrocatalysis and vice versa. There's no fundamental difference. They develop under significant chemical potential a dynamical interface and active sites. And these active sites are 3-dimensional hierarchical. You will see in a moment what that means. And that these nasty reaction intermediates that destroy the whole system. And if you want to be better than nature, nature has about this activity. then you have to be significantly higher in current, and we are higher in current, then you destroy the system. This is the little detail that we have to solve. That does not mean this is insolvable, but first you have to know where the issue is. This you see here, this is probably the first electron micrograph image that you might be able to see. This is electron microscopy at atmospheric pressure in water vapor. This is one of these iridium catalysts that have been made here at BASF. And you can see quite clearly, you could see how this whole thing was moving, simply because it was at one atmosphere. I'm done. Future strategy. The combination of model studies with rational synthesis and advanced in situ analytics provided us the foundation for catalysis. We have the foundations, we know how catalysis works. And you should not think this is all black magic, that's wrong. What we have to do now is we have to earn your money. So we have to convert this in a design strategy where we can use this knowledge. This is not yet done. This is where we stand at the moment. And we have developed together with BASF a strategy to do that. The strategy looks in science like this. So you bring together platforms. You heard this morning. Only platforming and bringing together different things is the solution. If you do this alone in your little chamber, you will not solve the problem. So we have to do in science the same. And we've constructed this. So a little bit of advertisement is necessary. This is one of the centers that BASF has formed in Berlin, and what we try there is not to make a better catalyst, but to bring this strategy to work. This is our target there. With this, I think I have done my job, about 1 minute over time. I would like to thank you a lot for your kind attention. I hope you will defrustrate yourself now at lunch, and I thank you very much for your kind attention.
BASF. We create chemistry.